Hello again. Welcome to another episode of Community Questions that I'm allowed to host. I've decided to move the format around a little bit. All these questions are in some way about regularization techniques. So instead of going through them rather randomly, I'll try to explain things a bit more orderly. Feel free to skip to either part using the timestamps below. So, what is regularization? And yes, everyone who writes it with a Z is a bloody savage. Sorry, Leticia. A regularization is any technique that helps your neural network to solve your objective function in a better way. Put simply, your objective or loss function tells your net what to do, and regularization is added to tell it how it should do that. As a simple example, consider fitting a function through these given points. While the red curve does hit every sample point, it generalizes badly for the samples not seen during training. It is overfitting. A regularization term here could enforce smoothness, giving you that nice green curve that you can see. Usually, these regularizations are added as an extra term to the loss function. So, two very common regularizations that are already built in most optimizers, such as Adam, would be L1 and Tikhonov regularization, that is also known as L2 or weight decay. L1 regularization just adds the absolute sum of all weights of the network to the loss term, whereas Tikhonov or L2 regularization does the same for the squared weights. In practice, that just means that L1 does not care which weights we actually touch, as long as we are always getting lower in total. For L2 regularization, this changes. As we square each weight, this is always punishing the highest weight the most. So, while L2 regularization and Tikhonov mean the same, L2 regularization shrinks the weights more evenly than L1, preferring to punish the higher weights more than the lower ones. And L2 does this in a linear way, always just preferring to get the total sum of the weights down. If we reconsider our example from the beginning, we can easily see why having either regularization term is helpful. To form a curve such as the red line, we'd need much higher weights, very informally spoken, please don't hit me for that, sharper turns of the output function require larger weights, whereas, for example, a flat line can be produced just with all weights being zero. So, this also helps against overfitting while improving generalization by preferring the green over the red line. Easy solutions just tend to generalize better than memorizing every last bit of the training data. Now let's look at one regularization for the analysis lovers. Let's quickly repeat what Lipschitz continuity is and see how we can use that to, for example, better train GANs or defend against adversarial attacks. A function is Lipschitz continuous with a Lipschitz constant c if a change applied to its input value never changes the output value by more than c times that input change. Or, with other words, there is some upper limit to the slope of this function. As our networks are also just piecewise linear functions, we can also compute the Lipschitz constant for them. Discretely spoken, this means that for any two samples of the input, their output distance relative to the input distance should at most be that Lipschitz constant. Meaning, for a network that is Lipschitz continuous, when we fiddle around with one single input, the output change occurring has some upper bound. And that is already the answer to this question. A simple way of enforcing Lipschitz continuity is the so-called weight clipping. The output of a network always depends on its weights, and when we simply set an upper limit to the absolute value of a weight, that is, we just clip any weight that is larger than this limit, we already obtain a very crude limit on how much a change in the input can change the output, leaving us with a Lipschitz bound. It's just the same argument as before for the L1 and L2 regularization. High slope needs high values as coefficient, meaning high weights in the network. And by enforcing that our weights are small, we make sure that the learned function does not have any of these sharp turns that we do not want. Now let's have a look at what else this is good for. Imagine that you want to train a GAN, and I'm explicitly saying imagine here because these things are a pain to train. So, you train your GAN, and during training, your discriminator becomes way too good for the generator. That means that you suddenly have a strong jump in your discriminator, and meaning that when your generator is producing super fake outputs, slightly changing something, as you'd usually do when training networks, won't help at all. Your output will still be very much fake. Hence, you basically end up with a vanishing gradient problem. There is just no clear direction in which your gradient points that can help you. You'd need to change a whole lot of things, and then, suddenly, the discriminator gets to this jump and thinks your generated output is real. And this, of course, means that you can't properly train your generator anymore. Big problem, lots of headache. So, what do you do about that? Well, you don't want these jumps in your loss function. You want your loss function to smoothly change with a limited rate of change, which is exactly what a Lipschitz bound for your network does. So, for example, you enforce Lipschitz continuity through weight clipping, and boom, things get better. Mostly. Sometimes. GANs are lots of fun. Now, before you run off and use that knowledge, don't, because there is an even better regularization technique. Lipschitz continuity prevents you from having steep changes in the loss, but it does not prevent local optima or the function changing only slowly or not at all. Much better than that, we can simply say that our network should not be Lipschitz bound, but instead also exactly change by some constant relative to the input change. Meaning, our regularization term is just enforcing a constant gradient, for example 1, everywhere, which in theory means that there is no local optimum anymore. A function, a neural network, with a constant gradient like 1 everywhere has not one spot where the gradient is 0. It is just some linear function. And as we all know, a local optimum has always a gradient of 0. And on such a linear function, we can train even better. Lastly, Lipschitz regularization can also help us against adversarial attacks. For adversarial attacks, we usually look for a tiny shift in the input that causes a large shift in the output. For example, when we add almost invisible noise perturbations to this image of a panda, we can make it look like a gibbon to a classifier that we trained before. Well, if only there was such a thing to make sure these tiny input changes do not totally change the output. Well, again, Lipschitz regularization to the rescue. Enforcing a somewhat low Lipschitz constant for the network means that for an input that is only slightly changed, we cannot change the output by much. Or in other words, we need to shift a lot more pixels, much more visibly, to change this panda into a gibbon in the eyes of our classifier. So I hope that this was somewhat useful to you. As always, I would be very happy for some feedback in the comments and will leave you some additional links and sources in the comments. Bye bye!